session. I'll send the recording to all of you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So in this webinar, you will learn to implement various data platform or technologies into solutions that are in line with business and technical requirements, including on-premises, cloud, and hybrid data scenarios, incorporating both relational and NoSQL data. And you will get to know many more other aspects of DP200. So the speaker for this webinar is Mrs. Chitra Iyer. She is the Microsoft certified trainer, and you can visit her LinkedIn profile for if you want to contact or if you're having any doubt after this session. So I'll just give a small introduction of Mrs. Chitra. So Chitra is a data all-rounder with a unique blend of experience in multitude of data-related technologies. She has immense knowledge and understanding of technologies like big data, analytics, data lake, warehousing, SQL, machine learning, data science, with extensive technical experience of more than 15 years. Also, she has worked with various Fortune companies like Accenture, Infosys US, then L&T and Sintel, Capgemini, and many more leading companies. My words are less to describe her great work and experience in this industry. So I am definitely sure she will clear every doubt of yours. So now we can start our session webinar. And one more thing, if you you will all get the participation certificate after this webinar, we will send you a feedback link. Just fill your feedback. After that, you will get the participation certificate of this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Priyanka.
Thank you, Priyanka. Thank you, Priyanka.
Hi, good morning, everyone. This is Chitra Iyer here. Today, we shall look into the varying big data technologies using which you can implement your solutions. Yeah. What is the current trend? How the industry has changed the concept of the roles of who would be doing what? What are the roles and responsibilities in the industry as a developer? How it has changed, and what are the new persona-based roles which are available, that new profiles which are available, is what we will look into, and we will see how we can implement the entire data solutions using say data factory, data bricks, Azure SQL database, and Azure SQL data warehouse as well. Yeah, just give me a sec. Yeah, agenda for the day is like we would be discussing these aspects how the entire scenario regarding the data and the varying different types of data that one deals with have changed enormously, and because of which the roles also have changed of people who are processing such data. What are the different kind of storages which are available? When to use what kind of storage ideally? Plus, we would be looking into how we can perform data science activity using Azure Databricks as a platform and process our data and store it in a multi-modeling API such as Cosmos DB, which gives you distributed processing globally, and how to perform real-time analytics using stream analytics, and how to utilize ADF as an orchestrating platform and create pipelines to facilitate movement of data and processing of data via that. Last but not the least, the security aspects which are involved, and how exactly do we interact with all these different services without losing out the security and troubleshoot any scenario, any problems that we may come across. Yeah, that's the agenda. We would be covering small aspects of all these so that we would have covered all these to some extent. Yeah, given the time constraint. Ideally, people who are from this background, who have worked with business intelligence tools, or who are data professionals themselves, who are data architects, and also who are into development using any of the standard languages and technologies, they can also easily migrate to cloud, and what are all the aspects that one needs to keep in mind. But for trying out all this, the basic requirement is one should be conversant with Azure fundamentals, how to work in a cloud environment or cloud platform. So basically, this certification involves two different papers. One is DP200 and other one is TP201, which is on designing. Yeah. And I also shared, for those of you who are would be interested in appearing for certification in this area, I've given the weightage for DP200, how it is allocated, where we should have a strong hold on how to implement data storage solutions using the right storage for the different solutions, and opt for the appropriate kind of processing. Should we go in for batch processing? Should we go in for real-time processing? What kind of architecture one should opt for in designing the solutions with security and monitoring and managing the entire aspect? So let's just get started. When you talk about, say here, the role itself is data engineer. Now, earlier, as developers, if we know how to create solutions in the language that we are comfortable with, that would have been sufficient. But nowadays, developers, they are expected to have a knowledge of analysis as well, plus hybrid environment, like how to interact with the cloud environment. Yeah. Plus, you should be able to create predictive solutions, because that's the need of the hour. So let's try and understand how the data has evolved. When I started computing, we were having only data in terms of bytes, and max big data would have been in terms of kilobytes. But nowadays, we are talking about the volume of data in terms of petabytes and zettabytes. So let's see how to deal with this data, abundant data, and what kind of processing options we would go in for and implement our solutions. Now, when I say data is available in abundance via all the processes that we use, implement, we get data consumers, they consume wide variety of data. Like, for example, considering even the social media, supposing you put on a post regarding the place where you had visited, there are so many likes and dislikes, yeah, there are comments, there are tags based on whatever visuals that you have added. So the data is in a variety of format. It's not just the text, it's the audio, the video, right? Plus some other sensor-based devices. So much of data is getting generated, variety of data is getting generated. So naturally, as a data engineer, we are expected to know how to interact with these different data types and make some sense out of the same and harness the power of this data and come up with meaningful insights which will facilitate the profitability of our business using the appropriate set of tools and technologies. Now, when we talk about cloud computing, basically the world has opted for cloud computing vis-a-vis the on-premise, how we have been working traditionally. As say developers, we all must be already aware as to how difficult it is to ask for a particular source, even for working on a project in our environment, corporate environment, where you need to raise your request accordingly. It will go through a layer of approval mechanism, and then we need to justify why we need it. And once we get the hardware done, that's just not the aspect. We need to know again, we will again procure licenses for the software that we are trying to use, take care of the updates and patches, yeah, and provide for, let's say, make sure that the main server goes down, we are able to have a standby for the same. That's why we are talking about availability. And if there are number of concurrent hits to the website, I need to be, my solution should be scalable, wherein it can handle the load. Yeah, that's where we're talking about the scalability. All these are easily taken care of in the cloud platform. Since it gives you the facility, it also requires a new skill sets. Yeah, plus the approach towards designing our solution, all that changes. Here are some use cases for the cloud I have given, where how you could use in a web retail environment, you could use Azure Cosmos DB for multi-master replication, wherein you are having the high availability and you can access it with very less time. And in healthcare also, how we could use artificial intelligence solutions and help most of the patients and avoid the waiting time or waiting for the results to be processed and given to us. In real time, we can process the same and intelligently predict the same. And there are hundreds and thousands of devices which are around us. So from there also, we can consume data and then process the same in real time. Let's just have a quick look at it. We are going to look at the different cloud-based services from Microsoft Azure platform perspective. So let's have an idea about what are the different kind of services that are available. The idea of this particular topic is to understand the different storage mechanisms which are available to handle the structured as well as the non-structured data. Traditional way of processing has been with the help of a relational database management system, which expects the data to be stored in a structured manner. But now with the highly unstructured data, which are generated by social media, sensor devices, and other different sources, we need to have a mechanism of handling the same, by virtue of which we have, if you're talking about reading in the unstructured data in its raw format without having to worry about converting it into a particular manner and then consuming it, we can use data lake storage. Yeah. And for the, if we have a cost factor also involved and we want to provide for varying aspects like, say, replication and high availability, so on and so forth. But at a economical price, we can settle for the native storage, which is provided by Microsoft platform, which is your Azure storage. And we can process our data in real time using Databricks and come up with predictions as well with the help of varying libraries which are built into it, because Databricks is basically it's built on top of Apache Spark, which processes everything in the memory, and that's how it is able to give you the response in a quick span of time. And if you have again a large amount of structured data for analytics, we could use SQL data warehouse. Yeah, and to perform real-time processing, we have stream analytics. So let's have a look at what is structured data, semi-structured and unstructured. Structured data has a schema, as we all know, as we are familiar with working with a particular database or other, which is normally given to us by our DBMS. Yeah, when you say semi-structured, they don't neatly fit into a particular row table as a row and column where we have tags and key value pairs, yeah, and hierarchy to be represented. In case of unstructured, anything which I want to represent in terms, if I have multiple relationships to be depicted, I could go for graph databases. And if I have huge amount of data and I want to represent them in a columnar fashion, I can go in for columnar databases. We have MongoDB, RavenDB, DocumentDB for dealing with document type of databases. Yeah. And Azure itself gives you the table, Azure table storage gives you the key value store as well. Yeah. So when I have different type of data, the computing industry has come up with solutions for each and every type of data. And in this slide, we are going to talk about when to use what. First, what we are looking at is the Azure storage blob. So when the costing is involved, as I said, when I want it to be an economical budget, so it gives you a low cost, high throughput data storage, and it is capable of storing any structured, unstructured data. Basically, unstructured data you would use in terms of binary format. Yeah, they are stored basically in terms of objects. Yeah, but then we cannot query them where we don't need the, we cannot query them directly. There is no ad hoc query support with the blob, Azure storage blob. It is suitable whenever you have a lot of static data. Yeah, and most of the processing environment uses this as a main source of data store. For batch processing, HD Insight is highly, it's a service, Hadoop service, which is offered via Azure platform, which interacts with blob storage. And now when you're talking about data lake, when do you use it? You have unlimited, yeah. Whereas in case of blob, there is a limitation of, you have, in terms of terabytes, there is a limitation, though that's not a hard limit, it's a soft limit. If you pay extra, then you get to have more, but still it has a limitation. Now, when I'm talking about data lake store, there is absolutely no limit where you can have a hyperscale storage. And the best aspect of data lake store would be to not worry about a particular type of format which is required in terms of blob, whereas in terms of data lake store, I don't have to worry about the format in which I'm storing. I can simply store it while fetching it for processing. I can think of dealing with that particular format and then doing the processes. And you can interact with it for performing real-time processing as well as batch processing, as well as whatever data which are sent to you via sensors and devices. Now, when we say Databricks, this is, here we have a processing engine, in-memory processing engine. That's why it enables fast processing and it helps the data engineers and data scientists to collaborate. As and as data engineers, we would be curating the data in varying different ways so that it becomes suitable to be consumed by our data scientists when they are trying to create predictive models. Yeah. And also it has excellent security mechanism as it is tightly integrated with the Azure Active Directory so that you can interact with it with managed credentials. And when we talk about Cosmos DB, it gives you a multi-modeling API where if using one service, I can store my data in a document store or a column store or a key value pair or a, let's say, graph-based representation. And also it gives you varying, it does ensure transactional consistency by offering you varying different consistency levels. And when we're talking about relational store being handled in the cloud itself, we have Azure SQL database and Azure SQL data warehouse and the managed instance. Since the managed instance, SQL managed instance, also you can use in situations. So wherever you have huge analytical load of data warehousing, we can use it huge. And nowadays it's called as Synapse. It has been rechristened as Synapse, as your Synapse, which deals with huge amount of data in a structured manner. And for Azure Stream Analytics, basically it's used for analysis of streaming data from event hubs and IoT hubs. It has a specific query language of its own as well. And it's a fully managed event processing engine, right? And then we have Azure Data Factory, which is an orchestrating service, which allows you to interact with heterogeneous sources and create pipelines and process them via the pipeline and facilitate the movement of data from a particular source to a particular destination. And for organizations which are already using ETL tools or like say SSIS or probably different solutions, right? As of now, SSIS is what is supported here with the cloud platform, where if you would have already invested on that in on-premise via your SQL Server licensing and you have developed so many solutions that you can directly integrate it with Azure Data Factory. And when we have Hadoop, HD Insight is basically a service which gives you a lot of different clusters that could be created, such as Hadoop based clusters or Hedge based clusters, or if you have message processing, you can use Kafka, or real time event based processing, you can go for Storm as well. There are n number of options. Now there are 7 different types of clusters I can create via the HD Insight service. And then the main thing is this is SQL catalog, right? So what is the significance of this? It allows you to quickly locate your sources. Normally when we join any organization, the major snag that we come across is whenever we have to do our job, we will need access to certain resources where we may not have any clue absolutely as to where they are available and how to access them, how to ask for permission, from whom to approach. So many difficulties that we have. But SQL catalog, this Azure catalog allows you to create a metadata of all the documents and the processes which are available across the organization. And you can, for that, whatever resources are needed, those data sources could be easily maintained and access can be handled via that. So we have just spoken about what are the different storages which are available in Azure platform and how you can leverage it to do your processing. But who would be using it? The data engineer. So ideally, let's go and understand what are the different tasks performed by a data engineer on a day-to-day basis. Yeah. So now when we talk about modern data projects, what do you mean by modern applications? Any idea, anybody? Here we are going to talk about the new roles of modern data projects. What do you mean by modern applications? One which is capable of providing for not just the processing of data, but scalability, availability, yeah, as well. Plus varying, and it should allow you to do predictions. N number of expectations of an application has completely changed. How to interact with different sources and things like that. So basically, when we talk about in current scenario, these are the major roles that you would come across as data engineer, AI engineer, and data scientist. Now, when we talk about data engineer, it is this person is responsible for curating the data. As I said, once that person will have to interact with the source, pull out the data, check whether the data is suitable for the prediction applications, predictive applications, and for further analysis, accordingly do the conversion of data, which is the task called as data preparation. Like probably it may be something as simple as renaming a column, or from a given column split it into two different or three different aspects depending on what is the nature of data that is being stored. Yeah. Or maybe you have a data from that, using that as a sample, create further columns, whatever it could be, right? So such is the job done by the data engineer, and AI engineers will have to implement. They should also be comfortable with the varying different cognitive services and the different tools which will allow them to implement augmented reality, yeah, plus automation. We have process automation, robotic process automation. All that would be taken care of by the AI engineer, and the data scientist would help you with the predictions to create a predictive model which can be consumed in the different industries, right? So when I say data engineering practices, what do? They provision, they also process the data, they secure the data from unauthorized access, they keep constantly monitoring the solution that they have given you so that if there are any hiccups that could be plugged at the initial stages itself, and to provide for disaster recovery, wherein if the original server goes down, you are able to recover from that and continue your processing. Here in this slide, I've just given an example of how a project gets architected. So here, if you can see in the health industry, there are varying stages. We are, so here from the device, the data is fed into the IoT hub, which could be processed by, so ingestion is a stage where you are reading in data from the source. Now I can directly pass on the data to streaming analytics for further processing, yeah, or, and then from there directly pass on to the Power BI for visualizations in the form of dashboards, where the up-to-date live information, real-time refreshment is happening. On the contrary, I could also process the data from IoT Hub using Azure function, and then I can read it from the IoT Hub or data. I can store the outcome output to the, say, data lake store, which can be consumed by Data Factory as an orchestrating solution, which is picking up from the source and then after performing some process, push the outcome or the processed data to the data warehouse. From there, data could be picked up and projected in the dashboards and reports. Or alternately, I can directly pass on the data from data lake store to the machine learning tools or say libraries, which would help me to analyze the data and come up with solutions which can be passed on to a visualization mechanism like Power BI or Tableau or ClickSense, or probably I could pass it on further to some client applications. Yeah. So as a data engineer, we are not only expected to know how to interact with the data as a source as well as a destination, but also to care of different types of processing and choose the right method of processing, when to go for what, and using the appropriate architecture is also the responsibility of a data engineer. So let's just go into how we can create the data storage, blob storage in Azure, as well as create a storage account and deal with it, create a data lake store, and then work with it quickly. Yeah. So what are the benefits that we get to have by choosing the storage solutions which are available in the cloud is what this slide is talking about. First is that many time you're talking about on-premise, once you say the data onto the hard disk, it is our responsibility to take a backup, yeah, and keep all our softwares up there to date by applying patches and updates and provide for availability. Also for by virtue of say security, we should use encryption to ensure that our data is protected at every stage, yeah, and deal with multiple data types as well. And on the stored data, we should be able to provide for analytics. All these are given to us as a ready-made option via Azure storage. So here I've just tried to give you a comparison here between on-premise storage and say the cloud. First is cost effectiveness. Whatever is the resources I'm going to use, pay for only that much. Whereas here at in on-premise, I have to decide whether I want what kind of storage I want, network drives, or what type of RAID disks I want to go in for. For all of them, I will decide beforehand, and upfront cost investment is there. That is the first thing. And then we will have to take care of the backup, load balancing, disaster recovery, data replication. All these are our responsibility in on-premise, whereas here I can opt for a PaaS offering, and Azure Storage Blob is a PaaS offering where it's the headache of the cloud provider to take care of all this on our behalf. Yeah, and when we talk about storage types, there are varying different types of storage are available in the cloud, ready-made as a service for me. Whereas in on-premise, I will have to individually implement them myself and maintain the same. And the speed, the agility with which I could get the storage configured and ready to be consumed, yeah, is really great. Let's quickly go and create a storage account. These are the steps. So let me just give me a sec. Let me switch over to the browser. So to access Azure, you will say portal.azure.com. And that would take you to the portal. So here, let me just switch over to my MCT account. Let's provide the appropriate password and click in. So the moment you successfully log in, this is the home page that we would get in Azure, where on the left hand side we have the menu options, yeah, plus whatever you are constantly using, you would find them in the home screen itself, right? On top, on the right hand side, if I want to work with a cloud shell and perform some CLI based commands or say partial, all that I can do it from here. If I wanted to change my directory, I could go in for this. See, for first of all, what do we need to work with Azure Cloud? You need to have a subscription. Subscription is the topmost in the hierarchy. Once you avail a subscription, for availing that subscription will be associated with the Outlook or email account, email address. Yeah. So in my case, my email address is this, and that is associated with my subscription. And one person can have multiple subscriptions. Like I may have opted for a paid subscription on my own, plus I may be having, say, MCT, plus I may be having, probably when you're attending class courses, you may get to have passcode, which you may have redeemed, vis-a-vis also you may have got some subscriptions. So the different subscriptions, I can manage it via this. And any notification from the cloud platform, I'll get it in this bell symbol. And I can manage the settings from this gear symbol, which is provided here, such as the way how things are displayed, my favorite, whatever are my preferences in presenting it in a particular color, apply a particular theme, all that I can do. Anytime I want to gain help, I can choose this. And for giving feedback to Microsoft so that they can give us continued support in a better manner, feedback mechanism can be given from here. And this will show you the profile, what you have logged in and what are all the different directories you can, to which you can switch over. Yeah. So that's the general screen. Now, if anytime you want to create a resource, first I said you need to have a subscription which is associated with the email address. So the moment you create a subscription, what Microsoft does is it will give, based on the email that you have associated it, it will try to give you a domain, right? So how do we know what is our domain? Now for companies, you would ideally have the company name as your domain name, right? Because it's registered with the concerned authority and you're able to use that. Now, as an individual, if I am an individual who's trying to access, say, Azure services, I can create a free trial, which will give me $200 worth of resources. Yeah. And I would be getting directly on Microsoft.com as my domain name. Whatever is my email address, .onmicrosoft.com. So the domain name you can easily find out from here where it is, or when you will hover against it, that profile symbol you will get to see. And also, as you can see, it has given me a directory. Now, what directory is it? It's in an Azure Active Directory where all the services in the cloud platform, their credentials are being managed by the Azure Active Directory. Now let's quickly go and create an account. Now, if I say create a resource, I can go from there, and from the marketplace, I can simply search for storage accounts. And yeah, the moment I say storage account, I get to see blob file table queue. So I can select this. I'll come to the screen. Alternately, what I can do is I can select the storage account as an option here, which is there in the menu itself. Now, this you will get to see only if you have pinned it as a favorite. If I'm constantly using with some services, say, for example, I'll go to all services and look for, say, storage. And here, if I select it, there is a star here next to it, right? So if I click on the star, I had clicked on it, so it is pinned over here. If this solid coloring would go away, which means it will be removed from that favorite list. Yeah. For example, if I do that, it went off. Now when I do it, it gets added. So it's better to add it that way. So if you would have added that way, then you can pick up that option and you will come to a screen for creating a new account. Let me take you through the create resource option itself. So storage account, if I say I get to have this option and I just will click on create. What I am, let me brief you on the exercise I'm going to do. First, I'm going to create a storage account. In that, I'll create a container and I'll load some files. And whatever file data that I have loaded, that I would be storing it into the Azure SQL database using Azure Data Factory as a orchestration service. Yeah. So let's start off with this. As you can see here, it has picked up my subscription details automatically. If there would be multiple subscriptions, those would be shown here from where you can pick and choose. So right now I have only one. So my MSDN subscription is being shown to me. And always it's a good idea to create a resource group. You should be using, that's why earlier we were having Windows Classic service based, where like, you know, problem is if I am doing a consultancy for say 10 different companies, and I may have definitely, I would have used resources to create solutions for each of those companies. Sadly, I would have no way of getting to manage the resource at one place, because they all, I'll have to individually create, delete them, or move them, or whatever. Even for billing purposes, it was very difficult to look at it. So with the resource manager template, management template, which is, that's why it's called as Azure Resource Management Template. That's why it's called as ARM templates in short. So with that, first requirement is you create a resource group. So let's create a resource group and let's call it as a demo resource group. And click on OK. For our storage account, we need to give it a name. And that, let's say I'm calling it as a demo account. So you would get a message like this if that name has already been taken. So let me say probably demo 360. That is, it's already taken. So if I have a, like I've given a name which is unique, and once it is unique, you'll get to have a green tick mark here. You have to specify the location where you want it created. Ideally, it is suggested that to handle the cost aspect, choose the data center which is nearest to you. So I'm going to select Southeast Asia. Now you may say South India also, we can select, that is an option, but then not every service may be available in each and every data center. So that you will have to verify and then choose it. To be on the safest side, I'm just going in for Southeast Asia. And then the performance, standard and premium, costing is different. The options which are available in the nature or the kind of blobs that are made available are different. So you would go for the performance. So I'm just, for the demo purpose, I'm going to stick to standard. Ideally for enterprise production environment, you will go for premium. Now, when you look at the, say, account kind, there are three different kinds of storages that one could create. One is the blob storage. Now, the moment I say blob storage, I will not have access to create other types of storages like tables, queues, and files. Only I'll be restricted to working with blob storage alone. And when I say storage purpose one, let's say storage, select storage purpose one. But then if you look at it in your screen, you don't have the access tier where I can inform the cloud platform that whatever are the frequently used or commonly often used things, I want it to be kept in the hot tier. Whereas something which is stale and I'm going to not use it on a regular basis, I can put it in the cold tier. That access tier option is not available via general purpose one. But if I say it's general purpose two, I get to have the access tier, which tells me cool and hot. Hot is a default. Let us keep it as, so it's always better to go in for general purpose is a combination of blob plus other aspects like table, queue, files, other services, storage services as well. So it's better to go for general purpose. Plus version 2 gives me the facility instead of version 1. Version 2, if I go in for, I get to have the option of choosing the access tier. So let's go ahead with it. And how do I access it? Via a public endpoint. See, another aspect that we all should understand in computing is, see, as a concept, between two different, say, computers, how I would access or how I will make the two different computers communicate with each other by bringing them onto a same network, which is done with the help of network interface card. And with the network interface card also in place, the actual communication used to take place between two different computers at the socket level via a specific port, which is what is nowadays called as an endpoint. Endpoint is a communication channel via which you can communicate between different services. So here public endpoint is selected. I'm just going to go ahead and, if I'm interested in taking care of all these, secure transfer is what I need. I want the data to be protected and encrypted. Yeah. And this will come down to this hierarchical namespace when we speak about data lake store. Right now, let me just go and click on review and create. So then that gives me a summary page where computer tells me what are all the options I have chosen. And accordingly, it tells me if it is correct, it tells me validation passed. And I can click on create. So as you can see here, the bell symbol is trying to tell you the progress, current progress of your deployment or your creation. So once it is done, I'll get to have a message as deployment succeeded. And do you want to go to the resource or do you want to pin it to the dashboard is the option that you get. While it is doing it, let us go and create the necessary file that we shall need for our exercise, as I had stated. So let me go to a notepad and then create a comma separated file, probably let's say employee ID, employee name, and say designation, and let's say department and salary. Are the columns I want to create. Let's quickly put in some values. Let's say pilon and designation as MD and department as admin and salary to be 2 lakhs. And say Marina. And she's working as a manager in the admin department itself. And drawing a salary of 50,000. And let's quickly put in a few more records in different departments as well. Say Sudapa is working in marketing department as a manager and drawing 50,000. And Kamal also, but in marketing department, but working as an executive in the marketing department and drawing a salary of say 25,000. Finally, let's have one fellow from the EDP department as well. So Arjun, analyst from the EDP and drawing a salary of something like this. So let us save this file as say EMP and let me put it into the today's webinar folder.
Sorry, the name got messed up. So let me rename it as EMP and store it. Yeah, we have done. And our source is deployed as well. It is telling me deployment complete. And as I said, here we have two prompts as go to resource or pin to dashboard. Let's go to resource and see how what it has done. The moment you create a Azure storage, a general purpose version 2 account, we have not only got blobs, file shares, tables, and queues, all the different storage services also we get, and it is also telling us what is the kind of access tier and the performance that we have chosen. We have chosen standard performance with the hot tier and the replication mechanism. Now here I forgot to change it, but you can least is locally redundant. Yeah, which means minimum 3 copies of your data will be maintained by the cloud platform on your behalf. And also the location where we created it, plus our subscription name, its ID, all the information we are able to see it in the general tab itself. And if I wanted to say handle the permissions and so on and so forth, I'll go via access control IAM. And there is a Azure Storage Explorer, which is a GUI using which also I could upload data into the portal, I mean into the account. So first let's quickly create a container, and here let's click on container. Containers are nothing but a kind of folders in the storage mechanism. So let me call it as data probably. And what is the kind of access you want to give? By default, you don't want to give anybody permission as a birthright, but you would want to handle it yourself. So if you give them blob access, then only read access for blobs and container means all the blobs in that container could be accessed. So right now I'm going to keep it as private only, and we will give selective rights, and we have created the folder data. After going into data, I can upload the file. So if I click on upload, I get to the file which I want to upload. I'm choosing EMP here and click on OK and upload. Yeah, probably let's upload one more file as well, which we will use later. Let us say this is the document which I want to open and upload. So we have uploaded two different files. Like that, you can upload n number of files at a different issue. All that can be easily done with the help of Azure Storage Explorer. Now that I have uploaded these two, now what is needed? Now we have given a private access, right? Which means no anonymous access. Nobody will be able to touch this. Supposing this is a Azure Storage Blob as a service. I want Azure Data Factory as a service to access this. Yeah, or Azure Data Bricks as a service to access this. Then how will I do it? I can facilitate access, yeah, via something called as this access key. If you look into the access key, anybody who has the access key to a particular storage, Azure storage, will be the admin of that particular storage. So ideally, you should never share your access key. Instead, you would be sharing something called as SAS signature, which is shared access signature, which gives selective rights. For example, if I say access key, let's copy this also for you to be used later. Okay, right now what I'm going to do is I'm going to just open a notepad where when I'm trying to access it via Databricks configuration, I'll want the key. So let's say I'm just saving it as keys here. And our storage account name can be picked up from here directly in the display, so that it can be used in the configuration file later. But never should you, as a best practice, access the share the access key. Instead, you would, for whatever resource you want to give them permission, you will give the select the shared access signature. When you say go for a shared access signature, shared access signatures are themselves are again of two types, one at the account level, one at the resource level, right? So which is called as a local SAS. Now here I'm trying to show it to you at the account level. So at the account level, I can allow you access
to a blob service or a file service, queue, table. So depending upon whatever I want to give you, that much I'll select, rest I can deselect from here. Yeah, it's up to you, depending on the kind of permissions you're trying to assign. And then you can say, should I want what resource that person should be able to access? Any specific container only, but not at the service level, yeah? Or container and within that a particular object, or only a specific object. All that also I can specify. Similarly, what permissions do I want them to have? Should they be allowed to read from it, write to it, delete it, list it? All these I can specify. And over and above, we can mention from what time till what time this permission should be in effect. And as you can see here, there are allowed IP addresses here. When would I use it? If I want to allow a particular user to access my resource in the cloud via using a particular machine only, then I would mention, say this is the single IP address or probably a range of IP addresses depending upon what I want to give. And do I want them to access it using only a secured channel or only both the secured as well as non-secured? Then that depends. That's where I would use HTTPS only or HTTPS and HTTP. Yeah. And as you can see here, all these are authorized by the access key, which is your key one. Clear? This is your SaaS at the account level. Supposing we created a container called a data, and in that I have an EMP file. So only for this, if I wanted to, let's say, create a SaaS, then also I can do that. So that will be my local SaaS. So as you can see here, there is a generate SaaS option, and I can mention what all permissions I want to give to that person. Say read, write, create, whatever permissions I want, and when to when that permission should be active. Yeah, that expiry date, starting date, all that is given here, plus the allowed IP addresses, from which machine only should that person be accessing it, I can mention. And then I can click on this generate SaaS token. Yeah, so either way, if the best of practice says that, do not share the access key, only the SaaS tokens should be shared with the relevant people. Accordingly, you can access it. Yeah. Let's see whether I'm able to access it. How do we check it out? So supposing I select EMP text and then generate SaaS, and I'll go for all these permissions, read, write, and create. Yeah. And then simply generate a SaaS token. And once you have done that, if you scroll down, you will get to see that token and the URL. Right. So this is just the token. If I'm going to access it, if I'm going to use this, I will have to write the URL, and to that URL in the queries, as a query string, you should attach the token. The entire thing is populated here. So I'll select copy this. And if I open it in the browser, it will simply allow me to download that file. There it's opened it, and I can just save it and download whatever I want with it. So I'm able to have access to that. So ideally you would be sharing things with the access token. So let's just get back to our example. We have just created the file and uploaded it into my account. Now let's go and create a Azure Data Factory service, because using that only I'm going to copy. But where are we going to copy? To Azure SQL database. So for that, I need to create a Azure SQL database service in the first place. So I can either click on SQL databases and then go ahead and do it. But if this is not pinned up as a favorite, then from the create resource option from the marketplace, I will search for Azure SQL database. Yeah, so there are n number of options. The moment I say Azure SQL, I have got n number of options here. So if I say SQL database, I've got Azure SQL, right? Just select that and go through this.
What do I want to create? Do I want to create SQL in a virtual machine or a managed instance or a database? So when do I go in for what? If I want to look after the management of the entire SQL server and maintenance of applying, updating, patch, applying updates and patches plus replication, high availability, disaster recovery solution, whatever aspect, and our maintenance is my headache. If I want it to be that way and I want to have a better control over that SQL server, I'll go for SQL server on a virtual machine. But when I say that, okay, I don't want all this headache, I want to only interact with that as a database, the entire maintenance headache, maintaining and managing the entire database is the responsibility of the cloud provider, I'll go for SQL databases. This, but then Azure SQL database as a PaaS service never used to give us all the options as I would have got it with the on-premise SQL server. Okay, but supposing if I want all those options, what I would have got via the on-premise SQL server, but as a PaaS service, that's when I'll go for SQL managed instances. Right now, I'm just going to stick to SQL database and click on create. Now, since it's a PaaS service, it will create a logical server on my behalf. Yeah. So I'm using the same subscription and the same resource group. And let's put in a name for the database, which is probably, let's say, sample DB. And which server am I intending to use? I already happen to have a server here in Southeast Asia in the name of TSR server. If I wanted to create a new one, I could have clicked on create new and I could have provided the name of the server. Let's say demo server, demo SRVR. Then I could give a login. So I am giving SQL admin as a login and the password. Training $1, $2, $3 so that I remember it because there's too many passwords around. $2, $3. So now where exactly do I want to create it? So here again, I can say Southeast Asia. And that server name would get updated here automatically. Yeah. And what is an elastic pool? Now it's Azure, in cloud, basically we have for working with any system in on-premise also, if I want a faster, quick response, then my processing speed should be there accordingly. And my RAM capacity should be taken care of accordingly. Then the disks which I'm using should provide me with the appropriate IOPS, so that I get to have the quickest possible response. So the resources, anytime you want to process, you need these resources. These resources, such as the CPU processing power, the RAM, the disk IO, all the three put together are what is called in cloud parlance as data transaction unit, or in short DTU. Yeah, depending upon the number of data transaction units that I'm associating with that particular database, accordingly the performance of it would change. Now we have DTU based. In DTU based, what happens? My storage capability will also increase as per the, supposing for my processing need workload, I need higher processing capability, but I am not very much interested in so much of storage. Such a delineation is not possible in DTU, because the moment I go for high processing capability, I'll automatically get high storage. So to handle that, Microsoft has introduced the virtual core based options, which I can change here. So for every database, say supposing in my production environment, I have five different databases, which have got different needs. So for each of them, if I pay accordingly, and then I realize that some of the databases for which I've allocated resources are not utilizing it to the fullest. Always it's only say utilizing only 25% of the resources, but then I'm paying for the full 100%. So rather than that, I can avail a pool of resources in the form of elastic pool, and to that I can say, allocate my databases, cloud platform will automatically manage, depending on the need of the database, appropriate resources would get consumed. Like that, I can optimally manage my cost, which is the purpose of your elastic pool. So in this case, I'm not going in for elastic pool. General purpose, how do I change it? So by default, it's giving me 32 GB and there's so many cores, which I don't want. So I can just say, I don't want the weak core based, I'll go to the DTU based. And in the DTU based, I'll go for standard workload, where if I go for, let's say, 10 DTU, automatically I get 250 GB storage, which is fair enough for our demo right now. So I'm just going to choose that. So accordingly, I'll be saving on costing. Here again, I'm saying no access to my database via any public endpoint. Later on, I'll be covering how to provide access to that. And in this additional settings screen, we get to have options of, do I want to use any existing data? None is a default. So my sample database, when it is created, it will be empty. There will be no tables, no views, nothing in that. But supposing if I wanted to use a sample database, supposing like how in on-premise you get to have adventure works. Similarly, I want to have a database which is given to me ready-made. I'll go for the sample. Or if I happen to have a backup of some database which I want to restore and utilize, that's when I'll go for backup option. So right now I'm going to opt for say none. And then automatically it gives me a collation. Collation is important for deciding how the database is going to deal with sorting and processing of data. Yeah, so that's all I've chosen over here. And let's say next, if I want this to be detected easily by our searches, I'll give it a tag and do that. Right now, I'm not going to do it. I'll just click on review and create. Automatically, I get to have the summary page. So once the validation is passed, computer is telling me, okay, Chitra, you will incur 991 rupees for a month. Right now, we are going to, that's fine. I'm going to utilize it for just 1 hour. So it's fine, where the cost would be negligible. So now that I've submitted for deployment, this is going ahead. So we have the blob with us, which is having a container and the data loaded. And from there, I'll read that data and create a table and populate it in the, let's say, Azure SQL database. Now I have two ways of handling it. One is I can go to the database, create a table which is having a similar structure as my file, or I can also create it dynamically. Both the options are available. So I'll show you both the ways with the different examples here itself. So let us wait for this deployment to get done. Just give me a sec. Yeah, so now that the deployment is complete, let's just quickly go to the resource. See, we have said no private and no access to our resource, right? So if I have to access this via the data factory service, so I will have to give it permission by creating a server firewall rule. So I'll just select that and just click on add client IP. Now, I do not have, say, a management studio in my local machine. So I'm going to be using a virtual machine vis-a-vis and do that. So I will have to add the IP address of that also, which I will do subsequently. Just for the demo purpose, I'm going to just create a rule, which is say test. And I'm going to give a IP address like this, but this is not advised in the production environment. Absolutely not. Okay, just to make the demo quick here, I'm going through this. Yeah, so let me it's telling you allow Azure services and resources to access this server. It should be kept on, right? And I'm also adding a new rule, which is already there. Yeah, which we have already made. Yeah, and we need to save this. I've created a rule and I've allowed permission. So let me remove this extra blank. That's why it's not allowing me to go on. So click on save. Now it will be saved. I should get to see the message successfully saved. So I'll be able to access it. Let us check it out, whether we are able to access this. For example, if I go to my resource group, if I scroll up here, you have resource groups, and I have created a resource group. And if I'm going to select my virtual machine name, I've forgotten, so let me pick it up directly from here, DSVM 2019. So we need, I had stopped the machine to avoid incurring the cost. So now I have to start it. So once I started, it'll assign IP address. That IP address is what I should have ideally allowed as a server firewall rule for my SQL database, because I'm trying to access it from this particular machine. So let us quickly, let's wait for it to start. And once it is the public IP address, it has assigned us this. Yeah, so let me copy it and I'll connect to this machine via RDP. And once I connect to that, it has given me fast. So what I should do is go to overview here and click on connect again. And let me refresh this. Okay. And then click on connect RDP. Now it will be downloading the. Sometimes what happens is it gives you the message started, and by the time it is actually implemented, you would have downloaded the RDP file and that may not open it. Yeah. So I just have to provide the username, which is dsvm2019/sqladmin, and probably I had given capital letters. I've forgotten the. Uh, Okay, I'll just change the password. That's a different issue. 1 minute. We'll reset password again with that. So once the updation is successful, I should be able to get into it. Let's wait for it to give us the message resetting password successful. Okay, in the meantime, I have already circumvented it by saying 0.0.0 and this. Let's go and while it is resetting the password, let's go and create a data factory service as well. Data factory service is available under the analytics heading. And if you scroll down, last option is your data factory. Demo KDF. And version 2 is okay. We have reset the password successfully, thankfully. And we should get to have a tick mark to indicate that it is available. There are version 1 and version 2 of Data Factory. Ideally, you will go for version 2. Differences in version 1, we did not have integration runtime as well as we did not have branching, conditional processing, plus. We also didn't have many different activities as a option, which is being improvised here. So I'm going to use the existing resource group, what I have used. So here I can go in for probably, let's say, Southeast Asia, and I don't want to enable Git. Say for CI/CD in Data Factory, you would ideally enable it. In production environment, you should. So here right now, I'm not doing it. I'm just clicking on create. And it would deploy that, and it will give me the status as deployed. So in the meantime, what we can do is let's go to the virtual machine. And then let me try and connect to it because I have changed the password now because we need to access it via that. Let's try and do that. There, we are connected successfully. Yeah, and in the meantime, our resource also has been deployed. Let me go to the resource. Our ADF data factory, right? So I'm going to just put the case study to work. We have the data in the container called data M file in the data container of Azure block. From there, I'm going to read and put it into the table. So in the table, if I go and check it out, let's say we'll go and click on author and monitor in the Azure Data Factory. Anytime you want to create a pipeline, you would come through this option and you would be taken to a different screen where you'll be asked to choose your sign in. So I'm choosing my same MSDN and Let me come out of my email, which is causing all this problem. Wait a second. I kept it on because in case if the connection should be lost, I should be able to pick up that. So this is what I have signed in as. So this is what I'll go and. So this would redraw the screen and give it to me, the GUI from where I can. Just give me a sec, I'll copy this URL. And open it in Edge. So here I'm just giving in the just a second. Let me load the portal from inside my virtual machine itself since I've opened the virtual machine through Firefox. It's loading and then I'll copy the, go to the portal and pick up, say portal.azure.com. I'm just providing my credentials here to get in. So if I go into the data factory and click on say author and monitor, there it will open up the page for me. Such a page should have come there also. So now that I have got into this, I want, what is our objective? We want to copy data, right? Now when I copy data here, just provide a name. It's a GUI where it will take me through the entire process. So I can just simply say copy from blob to say SQL is our intention. So do I want it to run at a particular schedule? Depending on the nature of the solution I'm creating, for what purpose, I can say it should repeat itself on a recurring manner or it should run once. Right now I'm going to choose only once. Let's click on next. And then here I can, I need to specify the source, right? What is the connection? So here I don't have any existing connections with me. I'll have to create a new connection. And that connection is coming from Azure Blob Storage. My source is to be supposed to be Blob Storage. So I'll select that and click on continue. And in the Azure Blob Storage, so here it is asking me to give a name to my, let's say, the linked service. So what is a linked service in Azure Data Factory? That is nothing but a connection manager which is talking to a source. So because the connection managers are called as linked service, I have given the suffix as LS. Otherwise, I have retained the name as it is. And for communicating between two different cloud resources, I would be leaving it to the system to auto-resolve the integration runtime. And I'm telling the computer, use the account key, access key, which I said, na? So use that. And from where is it supposed to pick up the account? From my subscription. So I will select my subscription, which particular subscription it has to use. And the moment I select that, I'll get to see all the different accounts which are there. So based on the account I'm choosing, appropriate key would have got loaded. Okay. And I can test the connectivity. And once it is successful, I can click on create. So now the connection is successful. I'll click on create. My connection string would have been established. Yeah. So it is there. Now this is my source data store. But then computer will have to know from which directory, what file I want to read. So that is why it is asking me to choose the folder. So I'll select data folder, and in that we have the emptxt. I'll select that and say choose. So emptxt got chosen, right? So now if I click on next, it'll show me the data. So it is giving me a preview of data. So it's a comma separated file. I should be able to see all the columns like this. There were 5 columns which I had created. So those are being seen. So that is comfortable, fine. But when it comes to say schema is a structure, right? In whatever way it is existing in my notepad file, the same way it should, I want it to be available in the say table. So that is what I have to verify whether the structure is correct. But here, because it's a notepad, everything is taken in, considered as string, which I need to change. Yeah. So here I would, once I select this I want to change. First row as header has been picked up correctly. It's telling me where do I want to store it. So we need to store it in Azure SQL database. So here I can write Azure SQL or look for it. There. So here again, I'm going to call it as LS because it's a link to service, which is going to act as a destination for my copying. And from my subscription only, I want to choose a database. So I'll select that. So server name, I had created, I think demo TSR. And it will tell me what are the databases which are available. Sample DB is what I have created. And by default, it is the SQL authentication, right? Azure SQL database uses SQL authentication. So I'll use SQL authentication, and the username is SQL admin. And we had created the password for it as training one to $3. And once I have given that, I can test the connectivity. Now, if this is also successful, I can click on create. The very first step in creating your pipeline in Azure Data Factory is, first you would mention the source from where you want to connect, and the destination to where you want to do the copy, right? Which is what we have done. Now here I mentioned that container and the file, but here I have to choose the table. Do we have a table by the name for it to load from here? We don't. If I click on, had I created it, it would be found here, which is what I said, we can do so. Now, how do I connect to it? I will connect to it via SSMS. I can do it that way, or I can directly go to the database and then go for query editor preview. Either way, I'll show you. Supposing, for example, if I chose SQL databases and the sample DB is being shown to you. And in the sample DB, there is a query editor preview. So if I click on that, it will automatically pick up the username and I just have to provide the password and click on OK. It'll open up the somewhat similar GUI like mine. On-premise management should, it's not as exhaustive as that, but then it is telling me what tables are there, what views are there. Right now, nothing is there because we don't have anything except for the firewall we have defined. So I'm going to select table here, and in the query, I'm going to write a query. Create table employee, and it is going to have employee ID as a column, integer, primary key, and let's say name as Varkar, and 20 not null. And we have, I believe, let me just have a quick look at the data. Employee ID, name was there. Designation, department and salary. So designation, Varkar, 20, department, Varkar, 20, and salary. So if I run the query, the table would get created. So now if I will expand this, I'll get to see the data. I can also verify it from here by connecting to that. So I'm connecting, this connects to the window. If I try to connect to a server, let's say first I need to know the server name. So what is the server name that we have? I'll have to find out from my portal. So let's go to overview here. See, as you can see here, the server name is always the name which you have given, dot database dot windows dot net. So I'm going to copy that. That is the server name which I have to provide here. And I'll go for SQL authentication. And provide the username as SQL admin and TRAINING123. And I will be connected to that particular database here. As you can see here, you would find the server being opened and the sample DB being opened for me. There, right from my on-premise, by providing the server name which is available in the cloud, I have connected to it. If I expand the databases, I'll get to see sample DB. If I go to sample DB and expand tables, I'll get to see the table which I have made, which is employee. Yeah, DBO employee can be seen. Now, this is what I want to utilize in my Azure Data Factory association. So let's go back to that screen where I had left off. And now when I refresh, I'll get to see employee there, which was not there earlier, right? So I made it. I told you there are two ways in which we can handle it. One is we can create it and associate it. Second is we can tell the computer to dynamically create it. Either way, it is possible. So I'm going to select that and I clicked on next. And it will do a mapping. Yeah, this is where I can change. So here the data type I want it to be integer. In the source also, I want it to be an integer. Say in 32. And here also I can map it as say employee ID ENT. Name is perfect. Designation is perfect. Department is perfect. Again, salary. Your salary has to be a double or a decimal, which is equivalent to the numeric option. So once I have done the mapping, I can click on next. And click on next. A pipeline would be made. Computer is telling me, Chitra, this is the source and this is the destination. And these are the aspects you have chosen for whatever I have mentioned. Click on next. And a pipeline would be made. Now, because I went through a GUI, computer automatically creates the link, I mean, data sets, the pipeline, and it is also running the pipeline. If I go to monitor, I'll get to see the status of it. It has done the job of copying as well, where I'm getting to see the status as succeeded. Yeah. So let me, how do we verify this? If I go to management studio, I had just made the table. I did not say insert into those values into those table. So if I write a query here, as select star from dbo.employee. I'll get to see those 5 records which got transferred from my Azure storage blob into the Azure data factory via the pipeline. Clear with this, everybody? Any questions, any doubts in this? Since the time constraint is an issue right now, so far, any questions, anybody? I've just quickly taken you through how to create a data factory pipeline using Azure Blob as a source and database as a destination. Now, if I wanted to say use Azure Data Lake, let me quickly take you through the process of creating a lake. Gen 2 account there. Okay. So creation of basically Azure Data Lake store 1 and 2. What is the difference? First of all, let's understand the difference between a blob and a Gen 1. In blob, okay, it is object store. It is not a hierarchical file store, which means supposing I have say 100 files or even 10 files. If I wanted to change the name of the file, so what, how blob would handle or object store would handle it is, it'll copy the file with a new name and then it'll delete the old name, which means instead of 10 steps, 20 steps it has to do. First, it has to copy those 10 files, which is 10 steps, and then change the name of it, which is your other one, and then delete it again. But that could have been made very simple via hierarchical data store, which is your data lake gen 1, right? But if I want to combine both the qual, and but then in Azure blob I have the concept of replication, right? We have locally redundant, geo redundant, all that, whereas I will have to manually configure that and take care of it via data lake gen 1. The both the capabilities, best capabilities of both the features have been clubbed and released as gen 2, data lake gen 2. So how to create a data lake gen 2? Since it is built on top of Azure storage blob itself, I will have to go through the storage account option only. But then there I had shown you a hierarchical namespace, which I said we will enable it later. That's what I'll have to choose. So I'll use the existing resource group and then give the name as demo ADLS for Azure Data Lake Store Gen 2. Sorry, G went into capital Gen. And let's say I'm using the same location, or choose the appropriate location depending on the affordability or which is nearest to you. So Southeast Asia. What is the performance you want? General purpose 2. Here I can say This I forgot to change last time. So I'm changing it, ensuring that I'm changing it now. So all this will remain the same. Only when I go to the advanced tab, this data lake gen 2 hierarchical namespace is disabled by default, which I will enable it. Yeah. And then I click on review create the data lake gen 2 Ravi name. Now the credential which I will have to use for communicating with the data lake, the kind of security mechanism I would use. See, in blob, it used access key as a security mechanism or SAS token as a security mechanism. Whereas now in Azure data lake gen 1 and gen 2, it uses service ID as a mechanism. Yeah, I can use. Or that's how, and I should give you permission to the individual resources and then handle them to access it via ADF. So let me, now that I've created a account, once it is done, let me show you how to quickly create a service principal ID and access the same and copy it to, let's say, blob. From data lake store, I'll be copying it to blob. Now that we have only 15 minutes left, let me try and finish it off within that time accordingly. So what do I mean by a service principal ID? When two different services have to talk to each other, they have to carry their credentials with them, right? ADF is a service, your Azure Data Lake Store is a service. So since you're going to give permission to a service to access your data, here again, the only difference you will find is if you go into this containers. Earlier, it used to be shown as file system. Now, even that has been changed back to container only. Right. And let us create a different container here so that we will understand that this is a different container. This is my Gen 2. And I'll say, okay. What we are going to do is we are going to load a file here, which I'm going to copy it via ADF to blob. So let's quickly select Gen 2 container, and in that I'm going to upload just a second. Because my file is in my outside machine, so let me just load it from there. So let me go to the resource group, and in the resource group demo RG, we will have that ADL as Gen 2. And there we went inside the container. Gen 2 has already been made, and there I'm going to upload. Kennedy inaugural speech, I'm loading. So you will have some data in that Gen 2 also. Okay, so we have given, we have uploaded the file. Now I have to create a service principal ID. Service principal ID is always created via the Azure Active Directory. So quickly go to, let's go to Azure Active Directory. First of all, I need to register an application. So I'll go to app registration. And from app registration, I will have to register my app. That is a new account. I'll call it with a name. So let me call it as a demo app. And here I have got options like, do I want to allow people only in my current default directory? Or if I have multi-tenant account, where there are multiple directories, I want people to access it. All that I can mention it from here, I'm just going to select register. So once the application is registered, okay, this, if I go into the overview, automatically it creates an application ID or a client ID. All this we will need to be accessed via ADF. So I'm going to select the application ID. and I'm going to copy it in the same file where I had stored the keys. So let me call it as app ID. And you would need the tenant ID, which is always the directory ID. Tenant ID is this. And we need to create a password for this, which is called as secret here. So let's click on certificates and secrets. Let's click on new client secret. And another important thing is demo secret, let me call it as. You should never come out to the screen without copying it, because once you move out to the screen, you will never gain access to that particular key which it has generated. If I click on add only, it will create a key and this key will be lost, as you can see here. Copy the new client secret value. You won't be able to retrieve it after you perform any other operations or leave this screen. So I'm going to just copy this and put it into my notepad so that I can use it later. Right, now that we have generated this, I'm going to come out of this. I've created an app, but this app needs to be given permission on my data lake store Gen 2 account so that it can access all the resources, create files, read files, so on and so forth. That is the next step. First is in service principal ID creation, you'll go to Azure Active Directory app registration and you'll create it. Second step you should take care of is go to your Gen 2 account, and in the Gen 2 account you'll give permission for this app. So where do you give permission? You will select access control IAM, and in the access control IAM, that is identity access manager, you'll click on add role assignment. What role you should ideally give? You should allow the person that app to be a contributor first. Yeah. So contributor, I've selected. Whom do I want to give this permission? My app name is demo app, right? So if I write demo, I'll get demo app. I've added it. It requires these permissions, right? I'm giving the permission from ADLS. So then I'll give again add role assignment. I'll select the role as reader. Contributor will allow me to write, reader will only will allow me to read. So demo again app. I'm giving the reader permission as well to that. So it'll be able to read as well from my data lake Gen 2 account. And we need to say blob data contributor for that app again. Similarly, storage blob reader. So storage blob reader would be selected, and then I'll use the role, which is your demo app. Save it. We have given permission in this, but then does the app actually have access to the subscription? Which I'll have to do. I created the app. How do I give permission to the app to the subscription? Go to subscriptions on the left hand side and then go inside your subscription. And inside your subscription, also you have got access control IAM. And there you will add role assignment and give contributor role at the subscription level. Similarly, the reader role also needs to be given. Again, the demo app. should have the storage blob data contributor. Demo app. And the reader. To this app again. And save it. Now we're given permission at the subscription level as well as at the survey individual resource level. I'll be able to use this in my ADF option. So let me just go to the ADF. And let's create a new pipeline. Rather than authoring, I'll just go through the GUI because of the time constraint right now. So again, I can select copy data because this time I'm going to copy data from my data lake, so gen 2 to blob. So I can simply call it as copy from gen 2 to blob. So what we don't have, the source has to be a data lake store gen 2. So let us create it. And then select data lakes gen 2 account. And I'm calling it as a linked service. And account key, a subscription, you will have to choose. And then it'll ask you to select the account name where you would get to see that ADLS account. Yeah. Test connectivity to that. So once it is successful, you would go and select the path. Next. Choose the folder. So here I would choose the Gen 2 folder, and in that we have that Kennedy thing, and I'll select it. Click on next. So here I have automatically, it has to detect the format of that particular file. So here I'll say first row has header. There, right? Click on next. Now I have to mention the destination. I already have the blob storage created. So I'll create the destination. I'll just say next. It'll ask me which folder path I want to put it into. I'll put it into data. Choose file name, Kennedy inaugural. Yeah. And then it has created a pipeline, it has copied it. So I've taken you through the different storages which are there and how to quickly create a orchestrating pipeline for copying data. But this is not just the thing that you would do in production environment. You will also take care of lot many, processing pipelines plus analytical pipelines. So thanks for attending the session. That's all from my end. Any questions, anybody? Anybody, any questions? The only difference between ADF version 1 and ADF version 2 is in Data Factory version 1, we had a branching and control structures as an activity.
but it is added. So many other activities also have been added. That's one difference. Second is integration runtime was not there in the version 1, which is there as a part of version 2.
Yeah, Nimish, does that answer your query? Any other questions, anybody?
No.
Okay, as Priyanka had mentioned, if anybody else has any queries or doubts, you can write to me, contact me via my LinkedIn. Yeah, I would be happy to assist you. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dana, for such a wonderful session. I hope we'll organize one more webinar with you in future. So I'm going to mail you all of you the feedback link through email, and also I'll send the link in this message section. So just fill the feedback form, and after that you will receive the participation certification. And also our emerging technology community is open for everyone. So any of you want to take any webinar or any event kind of thing, just send me an email on this my mail ID. I would like to help you on this. And I want to announce one more thing. Like, we are having a year's big event, Global Azure Bootcamp. So for this event detail, just visit our social medias. So you will get the links for the registration and other details of this event. So thank you. I will mail you the feedback link. Also, I will share the link here as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.